the wind, her heart will yet be filled, and she will find true love. Good.
Yay.
Good. The AUC. Next year, in 2018, this hall is set to celebrate its 90th year here in Strathcona. For all these years, excluding the years from 1940 to 1945, when the federal government invoked the War Measures Act and confiscated and sold our Ukrainian labor temples, the activities never ceased here at 805 East Pender. And even during these unjust years, activities continued in individual homes, predominantly organized by mothers who wanted their children to continue preserving their rich cultural heritage. Eventually, with the help of the Civil Liberties Association, the federal government agreed to return our halls to us, and we have remained active in them ever since. To know the road by which our Ukrainian women traveled is to go back some 80 years. Events in the history of Vancouver, and especially in the trade union movement, are well documented. But our women are not always credited for the incredible contributions they made behind the scenes. We know, for example, that by 1935, every port in British Columbia had been organized by the International Longshoremen's Association. In response, the Shipping Federation locked out 50 dockers in Powell River. A further 900 workers were locked out in Vancouver. When 1,000 workers marched to Ballantyne Pier to where the scabs were unloading ships, they were met with unprecedented brutality by the local police and the RCMP. For some 3 hours, the demonstrators were clubbed and shot at. The casualties were taken or made their way to a makeshift hospital here at the Ukrainian Hall. Our women came with whatever they could spare to help those injured, rags for bandages and food for the hungry. This hall would again serve as a makeshift hospital in the aftermath of the 1938 post office strike. With relief camps and relief projects being cut off from federal grant money, thousands of unemployed men flocked to Vancouver in protest. Over a period of 6 weeks, some 600 demonstrators staged a sit-down strike in the main Vancouver post office. Of course, all these men had to be fed, and the people of Vancouver, especially on the east side, responded with generosity and their volunteerism. The women of the Ukrainian Hall immediately joined the Women's Emergency Committee and set to work. They would send someone with a truck to Lulu Island, which is Richmond, to gather as many free vegetables as they could get and bring them to the hall for the women to prepare. You can be sure that there would have been plenty of borscht made from those free veggies. These women would come to the hall and spend the entire day preparing two big meals every single day for the hungry strikers. 5:17 a.m. on what came to be known as Bloody Sunday, the police entered the post office. At 5:40 a.m., with demonstrators sitting on the floor singing protest songs, the police waded in with tear gas and proceeded to beat the protesters with truncheons. Hundreds of beaten and injured men were brought to the Ukrainian Labor Capital, as this hall was known at the time. This time, our women would have the assistance of volunteer doctors with medical supplies that had been collected as aid for China, but were diverted to the hall for this urgent need at home. In 1936, a beleaguered Spanish government put out a call for international volunteers to help them combat the looming forces of fascism. 12,000 Canadians, 400 of whom were Ukrainian, joined the Mackenzie Papineau Battalion and went to fight alongside 40,000 volunteers from some 53 other countries. The only aid that the Spaniards received was what common people around the world could muster to send them. Our women immediately set to work to collect money to help Spanish Civil War orphans and to provide medication for the wounded volunteers. They knitted socks and sweaters and sent tobacco to our Canadian boys fighting in Spain. They helped to purchase 500 pairs of army boots for those same volunteers. Unfortunately, Generalissimo Franco, aided by Nazi Germany, took over the government, and the stage was set for another catastrophic world event, World War II. Again, our women mobilized to help with the war effort. Funds were collected to aid orphans in Ukraine, as well as funds for medical equipment and supplies for Ukrainian hospitals. They would continue with fundraising for hospitals in Vietnam during the Vietnam War, for victims of the earthquake in Armenia, for victims of the Chernobyl accident, and countless other causes to this present day. In those early years, our organization was divided into various branches. There were English-speaking branches and Ukrainian-speaking branches, seniors' branches and women's branches. Women embroidered intricate designs from various regions of Ukraine on blouses and shirts. Costumes were sewn and accessories handmade. Children learned to decorate Easter eggs and make Easter pasta. Songs and dances were taught to adults and children, and Ukrainian language lessons were offered. These activities, spearheaded by the women of the AUUC, created a community where Ukrainian immigrants, many of whom lived in the Strathcona area, could find familiarity, create art, and keep their culture alive. Developing this sense of community was and remains an integral component of the cultural diversity that sets downtown Eastside apart from other areas of Vancouver. Many of the women from these various branches were tireless workers in the peace movement. One of the earliest slogans I can remember was "Ban the Bomb," and one which I have memorialized on an ashtray from the early 60s said, "Make love, not war." Many of us can remember the peace marches in Vancouver in the 80s, where even conservative sources estimated numbers of 100,000 marchers. The peace marches would take place on a Saturday. The kids would dance, the mothers would feed them hot dogs in the lower hall, and then we would all go to the peace march and march under the AUUC banner. This year, the Nobel Peace Prize was awarded to the International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons. Nuclear weapons continue to pose a threat to our besieged planet, and we may just have to dig out those banners again that said, "Ban the bomb and make love, not war." Women of the AUUC were and continue to be the heart and soul of our organization. Whether promoting cultural activities, raising money for important causes, or toiling for countless hours in our kitchens, women in the ranks of the AUUC have been its heart and soul. Some may even argue that the heart and soul of any Ukrainian home is the kitchen. From its inception, the kitchen has indeed been the heart and soul of our home here at the Ukrainian Hall. We shared our food with those in need. We shared our food with those who were new to our neighborhood and those who were already in our neighborhood but had never tasted borscht or holotsy. We made food to raise money to keep the hall going and to be able to continue promoting our Ukrainian culture. And without a doubt, at the top of the list were the quintessential vareniki, better known to most of you as pierogies.
Oh. memories for me. My son danced in the Dolphins Dancers, and he's moved on now to Ottawa. So this is a special home for Savannah and her son, Montana. And we just love you guys, and thank you for everything that you do for our community and all. And what an amazing piece on the history of the women in this community. Thank you. That was really extraordinary. I also want to take this opportunity to thank the festival team. This is the last official festival event. I don't know the exact number, but usually it comes in around 120 in 12 days. And at this point, I'm ready to shout, hallelujah, I survived another year. And yeah, it's a pretty amazing undertaking. And it couldn't be possible without the large web of community partners. There's over 50 community partners that we produce this festival with. And none of this could be possible without our extraordinary festival team, from Teresa Vandertoon, our associate artistic producer, to Savannah Walling, the associate artistic director and my partner, to Mark Carter, our production manager, Lelia Fraser, our operations manager, our program liaison, Maggie Winston. We've got stage management people here up in the corners here. Too many names to shout out, but I love you guys. Thank you for making such a great show here today. And I also want to acknowledge and thank our album residence, Kat Norris, and we have our new media artist in residence, Ganarji Sullivan, who's being Facebook live in the show. And thank you, everyone, and all. And I'm going to turn it over to Vivi. I'm really looking forward to this program.
We hope that you will join us for our hall's 90th anniversary celebrations here at the hall and at our end of the season concert in June at the North Vancouver Centennial Theatre. There will be more information coming out on that. We would like to now invite those of you who are staying for dinner to move downstairs. You might want to get something from the bar before you go down. And